WrestleMania 36 was supposed to take place at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. The show has a pirate theme. If you look at the poster, you have superstars that look like they're in a Pirates of the Caribbean movie. I assume that WWE was planning on building a giant pirate ship as the entrance stage at WrestleMania. Unfortunately, the show was moved to the WWE Performance Center in Orlando, Florida, once the coronavirus pandemic occurred. The show was filmed on March 25th to the 26th, and this is the first WrestleMania to be taped and not live. This will be the first WrestleMania in front of a record-setting attendance of 0 people. And this will be the first WrestleMania to take place over the course of 2 nights. Now, I hope this is permanent. I think next year for WrestleMania 37 in Los Angeles, it should be a 2-night event. Night 1 takes place tonight. And although this feels absolutely nothing like a WrestleMania, I still hope we get a good show tonight, and hopefully WWE can give its fans some much-needed entertainment. The kickoff pre-show begins with Corey Graves and Peter Rosenberg previewing the show from a studio. I'm not sure if it's from the WWE Performance Center in Orlando or it's from the headquarters in Stamford, Connecticut. Here is what we have tonight. They confirmed it on the show. Now, these matches are in no particular order. They did not say exactly if these matches are taking place in this order, and WWE never tells us that, so I'm assuming they're all scrambled. We have The Undertaker versus AJ Styles in a Boneyard match. You have the Intercontinental Championship on the line as Sami Zayn defends against Daniel Bryan. The SmackDown Tag Team Championships now just a triple threat match, and not a tag team threat, just a triple threat ladder match. Both titles are on the line as John Morrison defends against Kofi Kingston and Jimmy Uso. Elias against Corbin, no one cares about that. The women's tag team titles are on the line. Asuka and Kairi Sane defend the titles against Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross. Becky Lynch defends her Raw Women's Championship tonight against Shayna Baszler. The Universal Championship's on the line. Goldberg defends against Braun Strowman. And then you have Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins. And the way they built it up, I felt like, is that going to be the main event? Maybe it goes in reverse. I'm not sure, but that's what we have. And for the kickoff pre-show match, we do have a match. It's Drew Gulak against Cesaro. Now, I want to talk about a couple other things. I do like the theme song for WrestleMania this year. It's Blinding Lights by The Weeknd. It's actually a very good song. I'm not a huge hip-hop guy, but I think it's a good song. And the WrestleMania set, it's the Performance Center. You know, you're not going to do, you know, a big pirate ship there. But I thought they might do something creative with the set. It's basically just the same thing you see on Raw and SmackDown and NXT every week. So it's nothing special. But right now, Drew Gulak, Cesaro. For all we know, this might be the best mat wrestling match on the whole show. In terms of in-ring work, it's probably going to be the best. They had a decent matchup. Not a great match, but I'm already noticing this is going to be a dreadful show to watch because there's absolutely nobody in the arena. And not even the arena, it's a gym, actually. They were doing good. I think if there's a live audience, especially a crowd that just gets into Raymond James Stadium and are excited to watch, it would have been good at WrestleMania. But here, they did okay. Ended with a cool ending with an airplane spin by Cesaro. It was a good ending, and it was a decent match. But yeah, there's a limit on what they can do there in front of no audience. That's going to recap, really just put an end actually to the pre-show. The main card begins now. We'll see. It's supposed to be 3 hours and 15 minutes in total. That's not too bad. At least we're not going to be up till 12:30 like last year. So hopefully they give us some entertainment tonight. The show starts off with Stephanie McMahon addressing the audience, and she doesn't necessarily say COVID-19 or coronavirus, but she acknowledges for the first time on WWE TV that there is something going on in the world, and she's basically saying they want WWE to get your mind off everything and provide you with some entertainment. We start off with the national anthem, of course. Who's going to sing the national anthem this year? They just used compilations of previous national anthems at WrestleMania and basically give us a greatest hits, and this was awesome. I loved it. I thought this was a great one. They basically took all the best parts and who's ever sang national anthem in WrestleMania history. Of course, who can forget Aretha Franklin at WrestleMania 3? And they just kept going through all of them, you know, just a compilation of them, and they sang the whole national anthem together, basically, and it was great. Then we get the actual video package for WrestleMania, and this was really weird. So you have a pirate-themed one. It's basically a Pirates of the Caribbean thing with all the big stars. Roman, Charlotte, Becky, Drew, Brock, Bray, you know, just the big stars featured on the show. And what they do is, in the middle of it, they have it getting rewinded. I think, what are they doing? It's basically a British guy talking over, and it just turns into like a parody, if you will. They're making fun of themselves. They're making fun of the pirate gimmick. It was really entertaining. I actually enjoyed it overall. I thought, this is actually pretty cool. This actually would have been amazing if they would have done this in front of the actual Raymond James Stadium. They had AC/DC, For Those About to Rock, that play during. I thought, oh man, this would just be cool. Imagine the fans going crazy. They say, welcome to WrestleMania. Oh, the pirate. This pirate ship's revealed, and all the pyro comes out of the pirate ship. That would have been the coolest thing ever. Of course, we don't get that, but that's what I was thinking. Now, of course, WrestleMania begins. And who welcomes us to the show but the WrestleMania host, Rob Gronkowski? Who gives a fuck? No one cares. Mojo Rawley joins him, and I'm thinking to myself, oh, I want to turn the TV off right now. I want to turn this thing off. I don't care about this. But that's how we started off. Now, the opening match was very good. It was the WWE Women's Tag Team Championship opening a show. We had the Kabuki Warriors, Asuka and Kairi Sane, defending their titles against Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross. Alexa's music hits first, and she opens up WrestleMania for the second consecutive year because she was the host last year and she started the show. So here she comes. She looks great as always. Always have to point that out. And Nikki's her partner. Alexa's clearly the star of the team. Next, you have the Kabuki Warriors make their entrance, and I was pissed off because I was thinking to myself, Kairi Sane was supposed to have the greatest pirate entrance ever at WrestleMania. Last year, I was probably doing videos. In fact, if you probably look at my WrestleMania video review from last year, I was saying, man, I can't wait to see Kairi Sane's awesome pirate entrance at WrestleMania. I was thinking to myself, this is cool they're doing this pirate theme just so Kairi Sane can have the best entrance ever. We don't get that. And unfortunately, we're never going to get that because I think Kairi Sane is done. Michael Cole and JBL on commentary. The reason I think that is because Corey Graves and Carmella, I believe they're quarantined. I don't know if they're sick. I hope not, but I think they're both quarantined. So Corey did some recorded stuff earlier in the show with Rosenberg in the studio, but he was not here. I think that might be because of that. Now, the match, it was a good match. I enjoyed it for what they did. You had a lot of fighting on the outside, some dives on the outside, a sunset flip by Bliss. They beat each other up for a while. There's some bumps on the apron. Asuka and Kairi are down for a bit, but they get the upper hand later for a while. You can hear them say everything, though. That was one of the problems. Like, everything. You can hear Asuka and Kairi yelling in Japanese. You can hear Kairi Sane's moans. Didn't have a problem with that. That was not bad. Now, one thing I liked was the fact that you can hear everything, including the kicks. There was an amazing double stomp by Kairi Sane onto Alexa Bliss, who was bridged in the corner. That was cool. Then they get the heat on Alexa Bliss for a while. They beat the hell out of Alexa. They're beating her down, and they really kick her ass to the point where she's out of the match for a while. Nikki Cross is about to pin Asuka, but then Kairi Sane breaks the fall up when she hits the insane elbow and stops it. That was really cool. Next, you have Asuka about to get the Asuka lock onto Nikki Cross, but Alexa Bliss breaks up when she hits a Twisted Bliss. So two great breakups with her own finishers. Now, as the match goes near to the climax, they double-team Nikki Cross for a while, and it looks like, okay, they're going to give the titles to Alexa and Nikki because they're getting their asses kicked. There's a cool Doomsday Device version on Cross with the powerbomb instead of the electric chair, but she kicks out. I thought that was it, but she actually kicked out. Nikki is able to get Asuka out, who goes into the ring post. She hits a neck breaker onto Kairi Sane. Then she tags Alexa Bliss. Alexa hits a Twisted Bliss on Kairi Sane. 1, 2, 3, Alexa Bliss pins Nikki Cross. Bliss and Cross are champs once again. Alexa Bliss, her first ever WrestleMania victory and sort of her first moment. I think hosting WrestleMania is kind of a WrestleMania moment last year, but this is her first actual victory at WrestleMania. I assume she'll have more and more moments, but this is her first big win. Kairi Sane getting pinned made me think for sure she's gone. I thought probably now think for sure she has to be on her way out. And I think Asuka's better off as a single star, but for Kairi, she is as good as gone. Next, we go backstage. We see Kayla Braxton looking great in her white outfit. She did an interview with Baron Corbin on the pre-show. I just didn't care. I don't want to see Corbin. Even if it involves Kayla Braxton, Corbin just ruins it. She interviews Sami Zayn, who looks like a bum. He looks awful. And it was just an interview with Sami being a dork. Baron Corbin comes out. He calls out Elias. He mocks him. He's not going to be there after he almost killed him on SmackDown a couple weeks ago. Elias is limping. He has a guitar. Corbin goes up the ramp, and Elias hits him, so he kind of equalizes the match. The match sucked. Didn't care. I was hoping it would go quick. It went on way too much than it should have. Corbin, he has his feet on the ropes, and he's about to pin Elias, but the referee catches him, and he has to break it up. However, Elias rolls him up and holds it tight, and Elias cheats to beat Baron Corbin. Elias defeats Corbin now. That was not bad. I know the match sucked, but Baron Corbin lost. So next, we go to the Raw Women's Championship. Becky Lynch defends the title that she won last year at WrestleMania when she beat Shayna's friend. Well, sort of, after Ronda had her shoulder an inch off the mat. But she did beat her last year in the main event to win the title, and the match also involved Charlotte. Becky defends her title against Shayna Baszler. So very early in the show, I was thinking to myself, Becky's going to win now. Even though I picked Shayna, I thought, okay, if they're doing it this early, Becky's probably winning because I think they want Shayna to have a bigger high-profile match. And this was very disappointing, to say the least. So it's not that long. I mean, I looked at the match times. You know, the Alexa tag team match had double the time as this. Think about this. If you would have thought the show would have taken place in Raymond James Syndrome, I don't have thought Becky and Shayna would have half the time that some random women's tag team match had as opening a show. No way, but that was true. I thought this was disappointing. I thought this was average. So you have a big entrance. You have Becky come out in her truck, the only real WrestleMania entrance. And this was done because Becky was supposed to get this major truck entrance at WrestleMania. You know, remember last year you had Charlotte come out of the helicopter and she had that major entrance. This was similar. Becky comes out in the truck, then they go back to the arena and Shayna comes out. Then Becky makes her entrance and the big Becky Lynch semi. I think this looks so cheesy. Anyway, I guess it's supposed to be like Stone Cold Steve Austin, but it's not working. Now, when they first fought, I thought, you know, this feels like a big fight feel for an empty arena match. And it was quick. They went after each other. It looked like Shayna was going to win. Becky's doubting herself. They used their own finishers on each other for a while. You see Becky go for the Cruda Firma clutch almost. And Shayna did get the disarmer. She got an armbar on Becky. Shayna, when I see her, she's not Ronda. I mean, Ronda, I think the problem is when you look at Shayna, she does not look intimidating. Ronda is like super jacked and super athletic and such a great athlete. You can't compare the two. You look at their MMA careers, there's just nothing to compare. One of them, one of the biggest stars of all time. Another one was just nothing. I mean, she was, in terms of women's MMA, she did was important. But, I mean, you look at the way Ronda's legacy compared to Shayna, come on. So I don't know if she really deserves to get this match at WrestleMania. I didn't like how they made her such a killer in NXT because I didn't think she was that great with her matches. I've always been critical of her. So the climax of the match happens and Shayna does her throw that, you know, she kind of picks you up in a powerbomb and she slams you to the side. She does that to Becky. Remember last month when she almost killed Liv Morgan in Elimination Chamber, but she does that to Becky. Gets her in the ring. She's going for the Corafita clutch. She has her, looks like, Becky's done. But Becky rolls her up and wins. And they took the exact same finish that they've used a bunch of times now from the Bret Hart versus Stone Cold Steve Austin finish from the Survivor Series in 1996. They've used that thing a whole bunch of times now, way too much. I think they used it for a match with Finn Balor and Samoa Joe a few years ago, if I remember. During WrestleMania weekend, not on the WrestleMania, but I think on the TakeOver, they did that too. They do that finish way too much now, but that's what they took, and Becky wins. Shayna looks disappointed. I guess they'll continue the feud, but Becky with the big WrestleMania win. Kind of a huge drop-off, though, where she was last year, considering she was in the main event now, the third match on the night one of a show. Beats Shayna Baszler in an 8-minute match. Not very impressing. Quite a big drop off for her. Now, one thing I can't wait for is the Undertaker documentary that's going to air, I think, after the second night on Sunday. We go to Sami Zayn against Daniel Bryan for the Intercontinental title. This was very disappointing. I did not like this. I did not like this match at all. I was bored. One of Daniel Bryan's worst matches in WrestleMania. He has great WrestleMania matches. This is one of his weakest. Bryan just chases Sami Zayn around the ring. He tosses him back into the ring. He finally gets into him. But Sami keeps interfering. Nakamura interferes. Cesaro interferes. Gulak tries to fight on his behalf. They fit on the outside for a while. It just felt like a SmackDown match. Daniel Bryan fights them off. He goes for, I think, a diving headbutt onto Sami. But Sami hits a haluva kick. 1, 2, 3. Daniel Bryan goes on to paternity leave, I believe, for about 6 weeks. I think he's having his second... Bree's going to have the second baby. That's his second child now. He talks about leaving WWE. I don't know what's going to happen with him, but he's going to be gone for a while, clearly, because you don't just lose cleanly to Sami Zayn like this. But Sami Zayn beats Daniel Bryan. This is Daniel Bryan's third WrestleMania loss. And I believe this is revenge for Sami, because I think 2 years ago at 34, didn't Daniel Bryan make him submit? So, yeah, Sami gets a win over Daniel Bryan. Next, we go to the triple threat ladder match. So I forgot to mention, this is now a triple threat match. That's a singles triple threat, not a tag team triple threat. Morrison against Jimmy Uso against Kofi. Kofi's a better choice for than Big E in a ladder match. Of course, Miz is out. That's why it had to be it. He's sick. And Jimmy Uso's the better Uso. Everyone knows he's way better than Jay. If they ever split out the Usos, Jay would be fucked. So you cannot have a ladder match without fans. This was a match that suffered the most without the fans. I'm thinking to myself, this can't work. Because a ladder match is completely dependent on the audience reaction. I was hoping these guys wouldn't kill themselves because this is in front of nobody. They worked really hard. But again, there's no reaction that hurt it. So they tease a ladder bridge early when they put a ladder on the apron onto the barricade, but they did not use it. They did use a bridge later. Morrison does an amazing spot in which he rope walks for a Spanish fly onto Kofi. And that was amazing. He was on one corner. Kofi is on the other corner. Morrison walks down the whole rope on the top rope, and then he hits a Spanish fly. Then the Uso hits, or Jimmy hits the Uso splash. That was a cool spot too, a cool sequence. There were some big parts. There's a part where Morrison basically kills Jimmy. He throws him off the ladder, but like we don't see where he lands. So I assume there must have been a crash pad. That's what I think. There was a lot of ladder spots, some beating each other up with ladders, some bumps into the ladder looked painful, a lot of dives outside of the ring. Standard ladder match. I thought they did the best they could do. I just thought the no reaction hurt. I thought it went on a bit too long. Probably could have taken off 3-4 minutes. I thought it would have worked better. Jimmy gets on the top when Kofi and John Morrison are on top. And of course, there's a ladder bridge landing down on the ropes. So all three of them are fighting for the belt. All of them have it. The belt is ripped off. So there's basically a hanger that holds the belt, almost like a clothes hanger, if you will. And all three of them have it, and they fight over it. But Morrison's able to retrieve the belts, and he falls off the ladder onto the ladder that's on the bridge as on the ropes, and he gets crushed, but he grabs both belts. John Morrison wins, and he falls off the ladder holding both belts, and he retains the titles for his partner. We'll see what's up with the Miz, but I don't know if he's going to be... He might be gone for a while, but John Morrison wins, and Miz and Morrison, for now, still the tag team champions. And I heard their music video, and it sucks. Yes, it's awful. Next, we go to Kevin Owens against Seth Rollins. They had a good video package here, and they had a good match. Seth has a great WrestleMania resume. He's had a lot of good matches at Mania. And he'd suffer only his second match here. KO has the KO Mania shirt back. Yeah, I love it. It's KO Mania 4. There was a KO Mania 1, a 2, not a 3, but there was a 4. LR Mania was inspired by this. I started this channel around the time I heard of KO Mania. I thought, you know what? I'm going to do something like that. I like KO Mania. When I start my YouTube channel, I'm using my own initials like Kevin Owens does, and it's going to be LR Mania. So LR Mania is directly inspired by KO Mania. I don't know if I've shared that, but that's the truth. So I'm thinking to myself, the show's a bit dragging with no crowd. This would be really good in front of a crowd because they're having a good wrestling match. Then they have a horrible DQ finish. I'm thinking to myself, no way. Owens restarts the match. He challenges Seth Rollins to come back in, and they fight. It becomes a no DQ match. Rollins uses steel steps on Kevin Owens. He uses a chair. And he actually got the DQ with the ring bell. But where the match turns is KO hits him with the ring bell, and he knocks him out. Then he puts him on the announce table, and he climbs a WrestleMania sign that's basically in the attendance area. And he jumps off the sign and does a big elbow drop through Seth Rollins, through the announce table. Holy shit, what an amazing spot. What an amazing fucking spot. He throws him in the ring, hits him with the stunner. 1-2-3, best match of the night by far at the time. Great match. I really liked it. We go backstage, and Charlie Caruso interviews Paul Heyman, who scares her at first, and he cuts a promo for the Brock Lesnar-Drew McIntyre match for tomorrow night, which is the main event, I assume. Next, you go to Goldberg against Braun Strowman for the Universal title, exactly what it needed to be. Basically the same match that Brock Lesnar had with Goldberg at WrestleMania 33 a few years ago. Same type of match. Spear by Goldberg. hits a fourth spear or a Braun kicks out, and then Braun hits three power slams, and he hits a fourth big one where he runs around the ring. 1, 2, 3, Braun Strowman wins the Universal title. Quick match, all it needed to be. We'll see what Braun does as champ. I think, this was going to be Roman's moment. They're going to give Roman a decent reign. I say give Braun the reign. You never know. We've seen Roman as champ. He doesn't really light the world on fire. So I say give Braun a run. Give him a decent run. Let him go. You know what? Maybe there's not going to be wrestling. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen in the next couple of weeks? Might be terrifying, but cool win for Braun. He's a Universal title. I thought it should have happened a couple years ago, or maybe at least a year ago, but he got the Universal title win at WrestleMania. So we'll see what they do with the guy. They do a cool WrestleMania 37 teaser in Hollywood. That show better take place. I hope it happens, and it's a two-night show like this year. I think WrestleMania should be a two-night show now. It should be permanent. But next year is going to be one of the biggest WrestleManias of all time because it's Los Angeles, California. It's going to be in that stadium, which is probably going to be bigger than the Cowboys Stadium, which was in 32. It'll probably have a bigger attendance. It's going to be massive. Fox is in LA. It's going to be massive. So hopefully we get a great show next year, and hopefully this coronavirus dies off so we can have WrestleMania 37. Main event time. The Boneyard match. The match everyone is talking about. Everyone's going insane. Everyone on social media is losing their mind about this match. It is awesome. It's one of the best things WWE has produced this year. Now, I'm not going to rate it as a match. If you look at my match ratings and my descriptions, I rate every match. I'm not going to rate this as a wrestling match. I'm rating this as a movie. This was an amazing movie. That's how I rate it. It was well shot. It was well done. I think it was amazing because they had such little time to shoot this match. I would think they would take time to do this thing. But the fact is that in 10 days? Maybe 4 weeks? 4 weeks they had to shoot this? This was amazing. Movies that are shot years in advance don't look as good as this. Now, they have a big budget, obviously, but the fact that they were able to put all of this together in such a short period of time is amazing. This was awesome. I loved it. AJ Styles basically steals The Undertaker's entrance. He comes out in the back of a hearse and out of the casket, and he makes fun of Undertaker. Undertaker returns as the American Badass. He comes out on a motorcycle. He has this Metallica song. I don't know what it is, but it's a cool Metallica song. I guess the Kid Rock song's gone now. But that's his new theme music, I guess, for the time being as the American Badass. This was amazing. It was just awesome. So first of all, they fight. They fight everywhere. It's just brawling, punches and kicks. No wrestling moves, exactly what it needed to be. They go all throughout the cemetery. They hit each other into tombstones. They hit each other into the grave. They use dirt. AJ throws dirt in the Undertaker's face. They use cars. That's used for a while. A casket is slammed. Everything is used in the beginning. Shovels. They have everything you can think of in a cemetery. And it's cool how they shot the thing. I don't know where exactly they filmed it, but it was really cool, the atmosphere of it. I thought the cinematography, it was also amazing. So I'm a movie fan too, so I can appreciate stuff like this as well. Now, there's a big old house and there's a big shed in the cemetery. Gallows and Anderson come out of the shed and they start beating down The Undertaker, and they're joined by Druids. The Druids break out of the shed, and these are all people who have been hired by AJ, and they're all against Undertaker. Undertaker is weakened. He kicks AJ's ass. He threw him in the grave earlier, but now he is weakened. He has to fight all these Druids. He tries his best, but he keeps getting his ass kicked. He's just about done, but he's able to get them off. He's able to get down Gallows and Anderson. AJ, however, takes advantage, and he beats the living shit out of the Undertaker for like 3 minutes. Just an absolute ass kicking. Throws him everywhere. He runs into him, and they go through a wooden wall, like a shed wall. Undertaker's breathing heavily like he does in all his matches, in which he looks like he's about to die. He is just killing the Undertaker. Gallows and Anderson continue to beat down. Undertaker is just done. AJ is about to bury this man. He has him in the grave. AJ gets in the truck where the dirt is, and it's over. All of a sudden, Undertaker appears behind AJ, and he beats the shit out of AJ. He fights him. He kicks his ass, and AJ gets up on the ladder and goes up on the roof of the house. Undertaker throws Gallows, I believe, off the roof, and then he does a tombstone onto Anderson onto the roof, which looked painful when you look at it.
Undertaker then grabs AJ and he chokeslams him off the roof onto the ground onto like this wooden plate or just like wooden platform. It looked painful. And of course, it's shot like a movie, so it's not actually happening, but it looks so awesome. Undertaker then takes a defenseless AJ, lifts him up in a tombstone position. He's about to throw him into the grave. He hugs him. He says, "No, no, it's over. I'm not going to bury you." He turns around, big boot into AJ. Undertaker gets in the tractor and he buries AJ Styles and he wins the match. What an amazing match. I loved it. An amazing movie, an amazing video. It was shot to perfection. This was wonderful. There is so much that's going to come out of this. I think this is a whole new genre of wrestling. The Hardy Brothers deserve a lot of credit for it, for the Final Deletion, Elite in the Cage. This was what it was inspired heavily by this. And they did do one of the things in WWE with the Bray Wyatt, Matt Hardy. So they did that a couple years ago, I believe. They've done stuff like this, but this was on a different level. This was just awesome. It was a 90s action movie. It was like an old horror movie at first, but then it turned into a 90s action movie. It was wonderful. I thought it was great. Undertaker defeats AJ. It shows the tombstone that says, "Rest in peace, AJ." I wonder how they write AJ back onto television, but it's WWE. It won't be too hard. They will still find a way. And Undertaker goes off on his motorcycle. You hear the Metallica song playing. WrestleMania ends. And that was great. What an amazing ending. What an amazing production that was. I love the Boneyard match. That was awesome. They have to do more stuff like this every year now. Every show. People are going to want this so much now. Am I afraid? One thing I'm afraid is WWE is going to keep doing it until this is not cool anymore. It's what they always do. But man, that Boneyard match is going to be legendary. So overall, night one, the main event was the whole thing to watch. It was amazing. The rest of the stuff was okay. Owens and Rollins was very good. I'll give it that. The ladder match was decent. And everything else, I thought the women's tag with the Kabuki Warriors against Bliss and Cross was decent. Becky, Shayna, pretty disappointing, I have to say. Not very good. Sami Zayn, Daniel Bryan, average. Braun Strowman, Goldberg, everything you thought it'd be. It's Goldberg in a match. It's quick. At least that's not, at least we don't have to watch it for too long. So I thought it delivered. I think under the circumstances that they did, best case scenario. You know, who knows? This coronavirus is such a disaster. It's such a nightmare. But considering the circumstances, I thought they provided an entertaining show for us. And I doubt night two will be as good because there's not going to be anything that's going to be as good as the Boneyard match. There's no way that Funhouse match is as good as that. But I thought it delivered for the show that they produced. I enjoyed WrestleMania 36, night one. Hopefully night two is a good show as well.